If you were to take a look at a chromosome, you would see that it's made up of this very densely packed material known as chromatin. And then if you were to further break down chromatin, you'd see that it's made up of a tremendous amount of DNA wrapped around these proteins known as histones. And DNA stores our genetic information. We get it from our parents and we pass it on to our children. And the DNA basically determines the identity of all living organisms. And just some interesting facts about DNA. If you were to take the DNA that was contained in one human cell and stretch it out, it would measure about 2 meters or approximately 6 feet long. So that is a lot of DNA to pack into a cell that's relatively so tiny. And how's that done? Well, with the help of those proteins I mentioned, histones, they help to wrap DNA in a very tightly coiled and very dense fashion. Just another interesting fact, if you were to take all the DNA found in one human's body and line it up together, it would measure, brace yourself for a very large number, it would measure 100 trillion meters. That is a huge number. In fact, something that long can go around the equator of the Earth 2.5 million times. So we hold in ourselves a tremendous, tremendous amount of DNA. But anyway, let's talk about the structure of this super, super important molecule that basically determines the identity of all living organisms. So DNA is made up of three components. The first is a sugar known as deoxyribose. And it's called deoxyribose because there's a sugar ribose that has an oxygen right over here, but deoxyribose doesn't have that oxygen. So this molecule is deoxyribose, and the carbons in deoxyribose are labeled. This carbon is labeled 1', prime refers to that little apostrophe after the number, 2', 3', this carbon is 4', and this carbon is 5'. And in case you're wondering why we need those primes, like why can't we just label the carbons carbon 1, 2, 3, 4, 5? So the answer to that question is that we're trying to differentiate between the carbons in this molecule. I will explain to you in a minute what this molecule is, but we're trying to differentiate between the carbons in this molecule and the carbons in the deoxyribose. So for some reason, the carbons in this molecule took precedence, and the carbons there are labeled 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, etc. And so the carbons in deoxyribose are labeled 1', 2', 3', etc. But anyway, that takes care of deoxyribose. And then the next molecule in DNA is a nitrogen base. And the nitrogen base you're looking at here is actually adenine. You may have heard of the molecule ATP, adenosine triphosphate, and that also has an adenine in it. But anyway, there are actually four different nitrogen bases that you can find in DNA. So I'm going to pause for a second from what we're looking at, and we're going to take a look at those four nitrogen bases. This one here is adenine. That's the base that we just saw a moment ago. And then right next to it, looking very similar, is another nitrogen base, guanine. And you can see that adenine and guanine are both double ring structures. On the left, you can see they have a ring with six sides to it, and then attached on the right, they have a ring with five sides to it. And well, these are all called nitrogen bases because they have a couple of nitrogens in them. And adenine and guanine are known as purines. So the double ring bases are known as purines, and I always have this hint to help me remember. So it's really an extrinsic hint because it has nothing to do with the material, but it always helped me. So when something is pure, it glows. So purines always glow. That was my hint, and then I would always remember that A stands for adenine and G stands for guanine. So if it helps you, you can use that. Then we have these other two bases. This one here is thymine. And then right next to it, we have something that also looks similar to it, cytosine. And you can see thymine and cytosine are single ring structures. They only have one ring with six sides, and they are known as pyrimidines. So again, the purines are adenine and guanine, and the pyrimidines are thymine and cytosine. And the purines and pyrimidines will always pair up with each other in this fashion. Adenine always pairs up with thymine, and guanine always pairs up with cytosine, unless, of course, there's a problem. And I want to just let's just take a look at how these molecules pair up with each other. So let's look at this diagram. So the bonds that hold the nitrogen bases together are hydrogen bonds. So it's hydrogen bonding that puts them together. And let's just remind ourselves, a hydrogen bonding takes place in molecules that have a hydrogen attached to one of three very electronegative atoms, fluorine or oxygen or nitrogen. Let me remind you, electronegative means that they like to hog electrons, they pull electrons towards themselves. And what's going to happen in molecules like this is that since fluorine or oxygen or nitrogen hog electrons, they are going to get a slightly, or maybe more than slightly, negative charge, which leaves the hydrogens kind of bereft of electron density and gives them a positive charge. And then the molecules will orient themselves in a way where the positive and negative sides are attracted and attached to each other. So let's actually take a look at what I just explained in the molecules. So let's look at thymine and adenine. So we have this oxygen over here, which is going to be somewhat negative because it's pulling electrons away from that carbon and in this double bond. And then these hydrogens are going to be somewhat positive because the nitrogen near them is pulling electrons away. And so they form this hydrogen bond right over here. Then we have another hydrogen bond between this positive hydrogen. Remember, it's positive because the nitrogen near it is very electronegative and hogs all the electrons. And then we have this negative nitrogen because it hogs electrons from the carbons around it. So between thymine and adenine, we're going to have two hydrogen bonds. But if you look at cytosine and guanine, there are actually three hydrogen bonds between them. So we can say that cytosine and guanine are attached to each other a little bit more strongly than thymine and adenine. And well, what would the implications of this be? So let's say we have two pairs of DNA, and we're going to soon see DNA is a double-stranded molecule, where the nitrogen bases pair up with each other, something like this. And I'm going to label this DNA set A, and this one I'll label B. And let's say I tell you that in A, we have a very high number of A's and T's. So let's say most of these are A's and T's. So I'm just going to, I don't know, put an A here and put it, well, let's make that a little bit clearer. So an A, and then there's going to be a T here. And let's say that most of this DNA looks like that. And let's say that B has a very, very high number of C's and G's. So here's a C, and here's a G. And let's say that most of the DNA looks like that. So B has a lot of C's and G's. So which DNA do you think it's going to be harder to break? And by break, I mean basically break the bonds between the nitrogen bases just like that and make two separate strands. And that's actually called, it's called denaturization. So to denature DNA means to kind of split it down the middle, break the nitrogen base bonds, and have two strands instead of one. So again, which of these DNAs do you think it's going to be harder to denature, A or B? Well, we just explained that between C's and G's, between cytosines and guanines, there are three hydrogen bonds. So it would be harder to break down B because it has more C's and G's. And so one way to denature DNA is to raise the temperature. That's one way to break down DNA. So breaking down DNA B is going to take a higher temperature than breaking down DNA A. That's just one example of why this fact would matter, this fact that thymine and adenine have two hydrogen bonds and cytosine and guanine have three. Anyway, now that we've discussed the nitrogen bases that make up DNA, let's go back to actually to putting our DNA together and the various components in it. So again, we said the first component in DNA is deoxyribose. The second thing we discussed just now were the nitrogen bases, and now the third component in DNA is going to be a phosphate group. And actually what I drew is a triphosphate. It's three phosphates together, and I drew it as a triphosphate because we start off with a triphosphate, but eventually two of the phosphates get lopped off and we're going to be left with only one phosphate group. So we're going to pause now, and in part two of this topic we're going to pick up on this and see how we put together all these components to make the DNA that we have in our cells.